in a non-reducing Earth environment, life origins in a deep-sea hydrothermal vent does not lead to a primordial soup. Without nutrient-rich waters, there's nothing to drive the selection of consumers or heterotrophic life. So, in a non-reducing Earth atmosphere, the heterotroph's first scenario is not an option. The only option left is an autotroph's first scenario for the origin of life. Nick Lane and his co-workers proposed that proton gradients were in fact the selective force behind the evolution of early metabolic chemistries in alkaline vents. Prebiotic structures and chemistries organized around biofilm compartments could have harnessed the free energy of natural proton gradients. In other words, the first protocells and then cells would likely have been chemoautotrophs. In the autotroph's first scenario for life's origins, the origin of replicating polymers is not yet satisfactorily explained. The focus instead is on an early origin of energy metabolism. If a natural proton gradient is a storehouse of free energy, then the question is not how individual chemical reactions might have been selected, but how a set of energy-capturing reactions were selected that then underpinned all subsequent metabolic evolution. The questions then are, when and how was the natural proton gradient free energy captured to power prebiotic chemical reactions? When did proton pumps take over from natural proton gradients in the alkaline vents? Was ATP the first high energy intermediate to power prebiotic reactions? And if not, when did the last universal common ancestor, or LUCA, achieve this milestone, since all of its descendants pump protons across membranes to make a proton gradient? They also use the proton gradient free energy to make ATP. They use a membrane ATP synthase to do this, and then of course they use ATP to power virtually all of life's work. Okay, so we often say that one of the earliest biochemical pathways to evolve is glycolysis. But in a non-reducing Earth origins scenario, there would have been no selective driver to evolve a fermentative pathway if there were no nutrients in a soup to ferment. Chemoautotrophs would harness free energy from proton gradients. When they evolved the capacity to pump protons across membranes, and this could have occurred even before life itself, electron transport redox reactions would have evolved in those membranes. Electron transport would source electrons from organic molecules, perhaps driving the selection of something like the Krebs cycle. Could that, in fact, be the oldest known biochemical pathway? Later, though perhaps not much later, oxygenic photoautotrophy might have evolved in local protected environments. I say protected because oxygen would be toxic to anaerobes then as it is today. Photosynthesis would have also co-opted membrane-bound electron transport and proton pumping reactions, this time to capture solar energy and electrons by splitting water. A molecular analysis suggests that while all cells can ferment glucose, glycolytic enzyme gene sequences of archaebacteria and eukaryotes share considerable similarity, but neither are particularly similar to those of bacteria. And this is summarized by the phylogenetic tree shown here. This is a tree we've seen before. However, this tree emphasizes that heterotrophy could have evolved from an autotrophic LUCA independently in the lineage leading to true bacteria on the one hand, and in the lineage leading to eukaryotes and archaebacteria on the other. In other words, the ability to capture free energy from carbohydrates may have evolved independently, that is to say, more than once. So the glycolytic pathway we share with most bacteria may not be the oldest biochemical pathway after all. It might have been something more like the Krebs cycle that was more directly linked to the generation of a proton motive force. Such reactions in photosynthesis or respiration are perhaps more likely in a non-reducing scenario for the origin of life. Okay, so let's sum up here. Speculation about life's origins begins by trying to identify a source of free energy with which to make organic molecules. As we've seen, the first cells could have been heterotrophs formed in a reducing Earth environment from which autotrophs later evolved. Alternatively, the earliest cells could be autotrophs formed under non-reducing conditions in the absence of a primordial soup. And only after these autotrophs had produced enough nutrient-free energy to sustain them did heterotrophs belatedly emerge.